been on this kind of visit, or I've experienced this kind of visit in my life. So it was with Brian that night he called Daryl, because he wanted to know, how can I get out of here? Enough is enough. This is where we get into the biblical text today. Here is Nicodemus visiting Jesus, might I add, at nighttime. He's a Pharisee, and it appears to me that maybe he kind of snuck in once he knew people to see where he was going. He visits Jesus. He's curious, but he comes alone and comes at a reasonable time. And as he enters, he begins with, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher from God. He does these things that can only be done by somebody who's in relationship with God. We know that the Pharisees have had an adversarial relationship with Jesus, but here in the demons proceed with this conservatory statement of Jesus' fortune, Jesus' profession, and Jesus' gift. Nicodemus comes to Jesus because he was painfully curious, like a kid that just can't contain that curiosity, in searching for answers from a teacher sent by God in the middle of the night. Like Brian, he didn't accept what was being told to him on the surface. Surface answers were not enough for him. Sometimes the surface answers are not enough. Sometimes we want to go a little bit deeper. We're not buying the status quo. We're not buying what people tell us. Nicodemus wasn't there because he had all the answers, but he was there because he was seeking answers. He was curious enough, stirred enough, to step out on the road less traveled for a guy like him to step over those boundaries that separate sometimes, to ask for help. Good for Nicodemus. For Nicodemus, it was hard to grasp what Jesus was saying. We know that being born happens at the beginning of life, and we know that we die at the end of life, and a whole lot of stuff happens in between. But how does one get born again? Where did it come again? Jesus isn't actually the easiest person to understand. I struggle too sometimes. So Nicodemus is trying hard to understand, but Jesus' talk was more like third grade math, mental and excruciating. He needed a tutor to decode the words, but all he had was Jesus in the now, who was also, by the way, sharing him a new one. Being born again wasn't something you did. It wasn't something you could buy your way into. It wasn't something you could monopolize or control. Being born again was something that happened to you. God's Spirit gives you new perspective. Our boy needs a mega pill. They're in, like, I don't know if you guys can imagine, you're of course here. And I had the bottles to bring, but the imagery is everything, right? But I mean, like, they were weighing my back, they were like, you know, that home. I went to see my doctor, and my doctor said, we need to give them to take omega pills, and I trust my doctor. So I went to the store, and I bought a bottle, but the bottle was dark. I didn't know what the pills would look like inside when I bought the bottle. So I got the bottle home, and I pulled out these big, I can't think of the other one, these big pills. And so I don't know, maybe I have a small passageway, I don't know. But I could not swallow new tack on pills. I mean, I've tried
Jesus was at that moment in time where we moved across the United States all the way from San Francisco to Virginia, from suburban to rural, that I needed God. And I felt God calling me also. Born again for me felt like a new lease on life, and that God really cared about me personally. And that's where the last two verses take us, in this winding road we're on with Jesus, because Jesus has taken over this conversation. We are reintroduced to this notion that God loved us so much, that God sent God's Son, and God did not come to condemn us. So people need to stop using this text to exclude or isolate others. It's not God's agenda. God loves all people. God loves the people fearful of the deportation. God loves the people that live on the other side of the walls that we have constructed literally and mentally and politically. I know this one's going to be hard for you to believe, but God loves the Democrats and the Republicans.
Oh, no.
This one is going to be even harder. God loves the burden and the worn and the violent supporters. You people put down my candidate also. I'm not going to put down your candidate unless you're Republican. But really, God loves us all. God loves those who have been signaled out in our criminal justice system as bad and criminal. God loves those people. God loves those that are stopped often while they're driving for nothing other than the look of their vehicle or the color of their skin. God loves those people. God loves the women who continue to march and the women who can't afford to march. God loves us all. God loves the Muslims and those, including the atheists who have no religion at all. God loves us all. God loves us all, and unlike many of us who prize education over experience or prestige or power over practicality or rules and rituals over relationship, God loves us all. And when we step to God, we're all stepping to God on an equal footing. God loves us all. Can you believe that? Can you get with that program? How do we help people to believe God loves them that much? For Lent, we are invited to give up something so that we create time for God. We are invited to give up something so that we make time for people. We are invited to step into a space to be brought closer to God. And by drawing closer to God, I hope it will help us to draw closer to people. Nicodemus, according to Frederick Buechner, could feel his own breathing intensify as he was listening to Jesus. What impressed Nicodemus even more than his speech was the quickening of his own breathing and the pounding his own heart. He hadn't felt like that since his first kiss, since the time his first child was born. I started today by talking about Brian and the skinhead who decides that he wants to leave. He had major death threats on his life. At first, he and his wife would take turns sitting up all night, but that's just how scared they were. And that's just how serious the death threats that were made on their life and their family. But Brian had help. He didn't do it alone. He visited with a friend by night. It was in the nighttime that he became critically aware. had a visit with a friend by night. And he also had an anonymous donor to pay the medical fee for him to remove every tattoo off his body, which took a total of 2 years. And Brian was excruciatingly pain to get all the hate from him off his skin. Because when Brian went out, people would judge him by his tattoos, right? When he went into the school, he had a struggle with teachers and parents. When he tried to get a job, nobody wanted to hire him because they didn't like what he sounded like. And so a donor gave him room so that Brian really could start all over again. Brian said he could even have a coming to Jesus down moment. But he had help. And he had a visitor that helped him do this. So I want you guys to see the visitor as exciting. Sometimes we see visitors as intruding on our life. Like Jesus, we are to welcome the visitor whenever and wherever they show up. Extend yourself. And I know a lot of you have already extended yourself. Listen. And just when that moment gets you to want to talk less. Don't be alarmed at the time people come, but be amazed that they're there at all. Hear them out, what they have to say, because sometimes people are carrying burdens. And then share the good news. Nicodemus never got to ask a question in this passage because Jesus was ready for the visitor when the visitor arrived. And Jesus starts in on him. And that's our cue, that's our line, that's our motto. As followers of Christ, hey, God loves you this much. Because people don't believe words, you gotta show people. Because words can be very shallow. God loves you this much. No condemnation here. God loves you how much? This much. You tell them about the Jesus story, or don't tell them about the Jesus story, but connect, however, whatever, whoever, just connect with people. And don't make it hard, because God never made it hard. I know you came for one thing, but I just gotta let you in on the biggest Christian pleasure. God loves you, period.